In engineering, being able to accurately measure how objects deform under loading is fundamental for ensuring the long-term integrity of structures and mechanical systems. One essential tool for doing this is the strain gauge, a highly accurate device used to measure the strain on the surface of an object. Strain gauges placed at strategic locations along a bridge can detect even the slightest changes in loading, allowing engineers to continuously monitor and manage the structural integrity of the bridge. And when attached to high-speed rotating machinery, they provide valuable data that can be used to optimize performance and extend equipment lifespan. They're essential tools for testing materials and monitoring structures. In this video, we'll dive into the fascinating world of strain gauges. These little devices that cleverly combine elements of mechanical engineering, electrical engineering, and material science to give us a way of measuring how an object deforms. Understanding the basic concept of strain is crucial for appreciating how these devices work. In simple terms, strain is a measure of how much an object deforms. It's calculated by dividing a change in length, delta L, by the original length of the object, L. Here's an example. Imagine a steel block that's initially 200 millimeters in length. If it's subjected to a uniaxial load that stretches it by 0.2 millimeters, the strain is 0.001, or 0.1%. The job of the strain gauge is to measure this change in length, and different strain gauge designs do this in different ways. Some use mechanical means. Others are based on optical principles. But the most common strain gauge design, and the one that we'll focus on, is the electrical resistance strain gauge. These strain gauges are carefully bonded to the surface of the object being monitored, and work on the principle that the electrical resistance of a conductive material changes as it deforms. As the object stretches or compresses, the bonded strain gauge does the same. By measuring the change in electrical resistance across the gauge, we can accurately determine the object's change in length, and so the strain on its surface. The electrical resistance strain gauge is made of a conductive foil grid that's bonded to a very thin insulating plastic film. A separate film encapsulates and protects the foil grid. Solder tabs allow the measurement wiring to be soldered directly to the strain gauge, and markings on the foil help with alignment of the gauge during installation. The foil grid is where all of the smart stuff happens. It's made from a conductive material that's formed into an intricate pattern using a photo etching process. The pattern is cleverly designed to maximize the amount of material that's stretched or compressed when loads are applied in the axial direction, while at the same time minimizing any stretching or compression of the material when loads are applied in the transverse direction. The physical length of the grid, called the gauge length, is selected based on the application. The shorter the gauge length is, the more accurately it will approximate the strain at a single point, which is why most general-purpose strain gauges are very small. But in some cases, like when measuring the strain of a composite material like reinforced concrete, a strain value averaged over a larger distance might be more meaningful, and strain gauges with longer gauge lengths will be used. The grid is made from a carefully selected conductive material. All conductive materials experience some kind of change in electrical resistance as they deform. In theory, you could measure the resistance of a copper wire with an ultra-sensitive multimeter and see how it changes as you stretch it. This change in resistance as the wire is stretched is the result of three separate mechanisms: the reduction in the cross-sectional area of the wire, the increase in the wire length, and changes to the resistivity of the material itself due to the increased spacing between atoms, which affects how easily electrons can flow through the material. Let's look at how electrical resistance might change as a function of strain for three strain gauges made from different materials. The graph shows the relative change in resistance expressed as a percentage. For material 1, a strain of 0.5% will produce a 2% change in resistance. For materials 2 and 3, the change in resistance will be 3% and 8%. It's clear from this graph that strain gauges made from different materials will behave differently. A strain gauge made from material 3 that produces large changes in resistance for small changes in strain will be much more sensitive and will be much better able to measure small strains. The sensitivity of a strain gauge is defined using a parameter called the gauge factor, K, which is defined as the relative change in resistance divided by the corresponding strain. It represents the slope of the curve in this graph. If a material has a gauge factor of 10, for every 1% of strain, the electrical resistance of the strain gauge will increase by 10%. Here are a few different gauge factors for materials used in strain gauges. Semiconductor materials like silicon have really large gauge factors of around 150. These materials are only really used in specialist strain gauges that need to measure extremely small strains. Most general purpose strain gauges are made out of constantin, an alloy of copper and nickel. It has a moderate gauge factor of around 2, but has other properties that make it a really good choice for use in strain gauges. It has good resistance to corrosion and good fatigue properties, for example. But the main reason it's such a good choice is its performance over temperature. Most materials have a gauge factor that varies significantly with temperature, which makes it difficult to get accurate measurements when working with large temperature ranges. But constantin is very stable. Its gauge factor varies very little from -50 to 150 degrees Celsius and beyond. In fact, that's where the material gets its name. And that's the main reason it's the most popular material for use in strain gauges. Strain gauges are usually used to obtain precise measurements of small strains, typically in the order of 1 to 1,000 microstrain. A standard unloaded constantin strain gauge has a resistance of 120 or 350 ohms. Assuming a resistance of 350 ohms and a gauge factor of 2, a tensile strain of 100 microstrain will result in a 0.07 ohm increase in the resistance of the strain gauge. Measuring such small changes in resistance is a challenge, but it can be done using an electrical circuit called a Wheatstone bridge. The purpose of the Wheatstone bridge is to accurately determine the electrical resistance of the strain gauge before and after a load has been applied. The circuit is made up of four resistors arranged in a diamond shape. One of these resistors is the strain gauge, and the remaining three are resistors of known resistance. Points C and D are connected, and a galvanometer is used to precisely measure the current flowing through this segment. The circuit is connected to a voltage supply, V. Each of the two branches of the diamond acts as a simple voltage divider, which splits an input voltage across two resistors. The output voltage of the voltage divider depends on the input voltage and the ratio of the resistances of the two resistors. Something interesting happens with the Wheatstone bridge when the ratios of the resistances on both branches are equal. The voltages at points C and D are the same, so there is no current flowing through the segment. When this happens, the bridge is said to be balanced. If resistor R4 is replaced by an adjustable resistor, its resistance can be adjusted so that no current flows through segment CD, and the bridge is balanced. When the strain gauge is subjected to a load, its resistance changes, causing a voltage imbalance in the bridge and current to flow through segment CD. By rebalancing the bridge using the adjustable resistor, the change in the electrical resistance of the strain gauge can be determined, and from there, the gauge factor can be used to calculate the strain seen by the strain gauge. It's a really clever circuit that allows very small changes in resistance to be measured accurately. In some cases, instead of using an adjustable resistor and a galvanometer, the voltage across segment CD is measured, and the resistance of the strain gauge is calculated using the voltage, instead of having to balance the bridge. The arrangement shown here is called a quarter bridge circuit. The strain gauge occupies one of the four resistors. A half bridge arrangement uses two strain gauges, and a full bridge arrangement uses four. Configurations with multiple strain gauges are often used in load cells, which we will talk about later, or for temperature compensation. Temperature compensation is an important topic because strain gauges don't cope well with large temperature ranges. Constantin has good temperature stability, but it can't escape the issue of thermal expansion. When materials experience temperature changes, they expand and contract. The amount a specific material expands by depends on a material property called the coefficient of thermal expansion, or CTE. The foil grid of the strain gauge and the material of the test item have different CTEs, so they'll try to expand by different amounts. But since the two parts are physically bonded together, the grid is forced to expand by the same amount as the test item. This means that any changes in temperature will induce a strain in the foil grid due to differential thermal expansion that gets added to the strain we're actually trying to measure. This introduces an error into the measurement, but it can be avoided by applying temperature compensation. There are two main compensation methods. Active compensation uses a second dummy strain gauge to compensate for thermal expansion. It's placed either in an unstressed region of the object being measured, or on a reference part that will experience the same level of thermal expansion, but without any applied loads. Both strain gauges are used in a half-bridge circuit, which cancels out the effects of thermal expansion. A simpler approach is self-compensation, where the strain gauge material is selected to have a CTE similar to that of the test item material. Manufacturers make slight adjustments to the composition of the Constantin alloy so that they can supply strain gauges with different CTEs. And all you need to do is select the strain gauge with a CTE that matches the test item. Strain gauges have a significant limitation that we haven't discussed yet, which is that they only measure normal strain in a single direction. This is a problem, because the strain at a single point within a body isn't one value, it's actually a tensor quantity. The strain tensor at a point can be represented using a strain element. It has components acting in the normal and shear directions, and these components change in magnitude depending on the angle at which they're measured. A strain gauge can only give us the normal strain for one particular angle, the angle it's been installed at, so a single strain gauge can't provide all the information needed to fully describe the strain state at a particular point. For this reason, strain gauges are often used in sets of three, separated by angles of 45 or 60 degrees. This arrangement is called a strain gauge rosette. The rosette provides the normal strain at three different angles, which is enough information to fully define the strain state at a single point. We can demonstrate this by constructing Mohr's circle, a method used to represent the strain state at a specific point in a material on a graph. Here's how it works. First, draw the axes. Mohr's circle for strain has normal strain on the horizontal axis, and shear strain over 2 on the vertical axis, with positive shear strains drawn, by convention, in the downward direction. Next, the normal strains obtained from the three strain gauges are drawn on the horizontal axis. Then the shear strain at gauge A is determined. For a rectangular rosette, where the three gauges are separated by 45 degrees, it's given by this simple equation, derived from the strain transformation equations. This defines the points on Moore's circle corresponding to strain gauges A and C, because the two gauges are separated by 90 degrees, and so have equal, but opposite, shear strains. With these two points, we can draw Moore's circle. Remember that angles on Moore's circle are always doubled. Strain gauges A and C are separated by 90 degrees, so there's a 180 degree angle between points A and C on Moore's circle. And there's a 45 degree angle between strain gauge B and the other two strain gauges. So on Moore's circle, the location of point B is obtained by drawing a line at 90 degrees to the line between points A and C. Once Moore's circle has been constructed, useful information like the principal strains or the strains in a particular direction can easily be determined, and Hooke's law can be used to calculate the stress in the material. Strain gauge rosettes come in many different shapes and sizes. This 2-gauge rosette, for example, is used to measure shear strain. If two strain gauges are separated by a 90-degree angle, the shear strain along the axis running between them is equal to the difference in the normal strains measured by the two gauges. Rosettes like this one are often used to measure the shear strain on rotating shafts, from which the torque acting on the shaft can be determined. Here's another interesting rosette design, used to determine residual stresses. It's fixed to the test item, and a small blind hole is drilled into the material at the center of the rosette. The strain gauges measure the changes in strain that occur due to relaxation of the residual stresses in the vicinity of the hole, and these measurements can be used to calculate the magnitude of the residual stresses. Strain gauges have so many fascinating applications. One very important one is in load cells. Sensors that use strain gauges to measure forces extremely accurately. Load cells are used everywhere in engineering, from weighing product on an assembly line to measuring the thrust of rocket engines. If you'd like to learn more about load cells, I've just released a video on nebula that goes into the detail of how they work. Nebula is a streaming site that brings you high-quality, thoughtful, and thought-provoking content from some of the best independent educational creators out there. It's a place outside of YouTube where we can showcase our work and experiment with different formats without worrying about the dreaded algorithm. Not just that, but Nebula is built and owned by the creators. We benefit directly from the support of our subscribers, and we have full control over the platform and its future. The video on load cells is just one of the exclusive videos I've published on Nebula. There are many others covering topics including the joint diagram, hydraulic systems, and dimensional analysis. But by subscribing to Nebula, you'll also get access to loads of amazing exclusive content from other creators, like The Logistics of X by Wendover, a really interesting series that unpacks the detail behind intricate logistics challenges. Or the Underexposure series from Neo, which uses beautiful 3D animation and captivating storytelling to cast light on interesting stories from recent history. And you can forget about skipping ads. Nebula is completely ad-free, and that includes sponsor messages, like this one. So if you'd like to watch my video on load cells and get access to tons of other exclusive content on Nebula, sign up using my link below, and you'll get a 40% discount off an annual subscription, which comes to just $2.50 a month. Not only is it really great value, but subscribing to Nebula is one of the best ways you can support this channel. And that's it for this video on strain gauges. Thanks for watching.